Greetings everyone, I'm Stefan, and this is a new improved traits tier list for Solaris 2.6 and beyond. This tier list covers all the traits available to regular flesh bags, and by that I mean standard empires, hive mind empires, megacorps, and lithoid empires. As you can see, there are certain markings on certain traits which indicate that they can be chosen or cannot be chosen by certain empire types. While I originally intended to make a tier list which ranks the machine empire traits as well, I realized that I cannot fit it all in a single video, and so I'll be doing a follow-up to this video with the Machine Empire traits. This will of course mean that this Ultimate Tier List series will be extended to 8 videos instead of 7, but that is quite alright. I'm sure you guys can check that out when that comes out. Make sure to subscribe and hit that bell so that you get the notification for when it comes out. That tier list is going to be structured in a very similar manner to this one. All the traits will be ranked according to their power level, and of course the cost is included in their power level. Something that costs a lot but gives a solid bonus will be considered differently from something that costs a third as much but gives half of the bonus. That is of course the example of very strong and strong, which we'll get to in this tier list. The negative traits are also ranked on this tier list. Obviously none of those provide any bonuses to your empire, but they do provide you with positive trait points. And so the traits at the very top in the negatives are those that really provide you the most trait points for the least harm to your empire. But anyways, let's begin covering the positive trait points with D tier, and then we'll move on to the negatives. Let's begin with Resilient. Resilient is an extremely, extremely niche trait, and unless you're specifically building a fortress world and modifying the species to have a Resilient just for the defense, it is not going to be useful to you whatsoever. Resilient only affects defensive army damage, which means that only the garrison armies spawned by enforcers and soldiers are actually affected by this. The normal armies that you create with minerals or energy are not affected by this whatsoever, even if they are on the defensive when getting invaded by an enemy. This means that Resilient has very few use cases, and while it does buff your armies a little bit, it is not at all worth it to use for your main species, especially in the early game. Next, we have Conformists. Now, one can argue that Conformists is quite a bit better in 2.6 than it was back in 2.5, but it is still not that great. It costs a solid 2 trait points, and the effective impact of this is going to be possibly increased influence production from Pops being in one of the happier factions rather than one of the unhappier factions. This is of course nice, but the effective result of this is extremely negligible and is probably around 0.0-something influence. Next we have Venerable. The problem with Venerable is simply that it costs too much for giving too little benefit. 4 trait points for 80 years of leader lifespan is not at all worth it, especially considering how leader lifespan is not going to come into play until year 60 or so, when your leaders normally start dying. You can extend their lifespan with something like Enduring and then start getting technologies to up their leader lifespan, but going all the way with Venerable is not going to really help you out, and unless you're stuck in the Dark Ages for most of the game and cannot get to those techs, Venerable is a very, very bad choice. Very Strong is similarly very bad. You see, Very Strong is an upgraded version of Strong, which gives plus 20% to army damage and plus 2.5% to worker pop resource output. The only problem is, this one does double of the effect of Strong while costing 3 times as much. The ratio of resources given per trade point is quite a bit worse than Strong, and quite a bit worse than all the normal, you know, agrarian, ingenious, and industrious traits, which give you flat bonuses to resource production. The army damage aspect of Very Strong can also be pretty much ignored, because unless you're trying to run some sort of, you know, army-only challenge or something, it is not going to come into play because, well, you can just build a few more armies and invade the planets just the same. Next, we have Docile. This is a new trait introduced in 2.6, and sadly, it has been introduced as one of the worst traits in the entire game. The thing is, Empire's Profit Pops minus 10% really does not affect your empire all that much. You're effectively saving, like what, 1 bureaucrat per 100 pops or per 200 pops? Like, it's insane how bad this is. And if you want to boost your production and actually use your pops, you should be using some other trait to modify your pops and to make sure you can have more pops working certain jobs and have more pops available to work other jobs. Docile simply does not do enough for the 2 trait point cost, and that is why it is so low on the tier list. Next, we have Nomadic. Now, while it does not share the problem of being way too expensive, it has the problem of not really doing it too much, especially later on. Nomadic will increase pop growth from immigration, sure, but immigration only really happens in the very beginning, where pops are encouraged to move to your colonies, and that's pretty much it. Later on, you're not going to get any migration push, as long as, you know, you're managing your planets properly. And since this tier list is optimized for an optimal playstyle, we're going to assume that you're not forcefully ruining a certain world, just to make sure the Pops immigrate to other planets and somehow grow 50% while doing the immigration thing. The Pops are getting onto a ship, getting transported to another planet in a few weeks, and all of a sudden there's like 50% more of them. Like, you have to wonder what is going on in those ships. But that is a whole different topic, and yeah, let's move on to Talented. With Talented, you will get extra leader level cap, but unfortunately, extra leader level cap is not that significant. You see, in the first 50 years or so, you're not going to get any leaders to max level, and only then, you know, after year 50, where you can potentially gene mod this onto your species, will it be somewhat remotely useful. Even then, it's going to take you a while to level up your leaders to an extra level, and even then, it is not going to produce that much of a benefit. For example, a scientist with an extra level will produce a whopping 2% extra research per month. That is not really worth it for the one trait point, and you're much better off doing something else. Moving up to C tier, we see traits that are quite a bit more powerful, but are still really niche and should be used in very specific scenarios. Three of those, gaseous byproducts, scintillating skin, and volatile expressions, are exclusive to Lithoids, and all of these will produce extra strategic resources per pop. So, for example, volatile accretions will produce 0.01 volatile modes per pop per month, and it will cost a whopping 2 trait points. This will effectively give you 1 strategic resource every 100 pops, and that is not really worth it for the economy. The only thing that this is worth it for is those early strategic resource edicts. There's a whole bunch of edicts out there that will increase your fleet power quite substantially, and so if you're doing that and actually going for one of those traits, make sure to go for a trait that will suit your rush economy and one that will suit you when, you know, going to war. Ultimately, the trait will only benefit you if you're going to war early on and are using one of those special edicts. Otherwise, it is trash tier and you should not even consider choosing it. The only other possible use for this trait is to get tier 2 buildings, such as research labs and alloy megaforges a bit earlier, but from my experience, that doesn't actually happen. From my experience, I still needed to research some sort of technology to produce strategic resources before I could start actually researching the building. Of course, that could just be my own bad luck, please correct me in the comments if I am wrong, but if it is bad luck, then it's really, really bad luck because I've run like 5 tests on this. Moving on, we have Thrifty. This one will increase trade value from jobs by 25%, and while that does sound like a very solid modifier, it doesn't really affect you that much if you're playing a normal empire. Early on, you should be avoiding using jobs like clerks, and you shouldn't really have any jobs like merchants, so all your trade value will be produced by your happy pops, and I'm not sure if this even modifies that value. Thrifty is of course great if you're playing as a megacorp, and in fact I would even rank it up in A tier. Other than this trait, of course, there's no difference in ranking for megacorps versus normal empires, but this is just the one exception that I decided to leave in this tier list. Next, we have Conservationist. This one is extremely similar to Environmentalist, which is a civic that reduces popular supergoods upkeep by 10%, but since this is a trait and it only costs 1 trait point, it's a lot more competitive than Environmentalist is as a trait. If you remember the civics tier list, Environmentalist was either F or D tier, while this one is a solid C tier. One thing to note about this is that it only modifies the pop upkeep. So for example, if you are running scientists which normally consume 2 consumergus upkeep, you will not be reducing that 2 consumergus upkeep, you will only be reducing the 0.5 base upkeep for the specialist jobs that actually work those science labs. Next, we have Quick Learners. This one will give you extra leader experience gain, and while that is much, much better than Talented, it is still not that good. On average, your leaders will be slightly more leveled than those in a normal empire, but even then, it is questionable whether or not it is worth it. Next, we have Enduring. This one will increase your leader lifespan by 20 years, but since it only costs a single trait point versus the 4 trait points for Venerable, it is quite a bit better. The thing is, 20 years lifespan is not really going to matter too much, especially if you tech rush and just get all those repeatables for extra leader lifespan, but if you're not tech rushing, and or you're not rushing fast enough, this one will be quite useful and will increase the time your leaders have to reign over your empire and have relatively high leader levels doing so. Moving up to B tier, we start getting the traits that I would actually consider choosing in a relatively balanced and min-maxed species. One of them is Extremely Adaptive. Extremely Adaptive will give you plus 20% habitability, and while 20% is quite a bit and can get useless quite quickly, considering how early you can get those plus 5% hab techs, it is still a very useful trait. For example, when you're colonizing those early guaranteed worlds, they will have a base 80% habitability. With this trait, they will have 100%, and you'll be avoiding a modifier of minus 10% to pop growth speed, minus 10% to pop resource production, and plus 20% to pop upkeep in terms of food, consumer goods, and amenities. This is a very decent trait for early on, but do keep in mind that this will have absolutely no effect on your starting planet, and if you only have a single planet, this trait is completely and utterly useless. Obviously, if you're playing something like Life Seeded with a one planet challenge, this will not matter whatsoever. But if you're not doing that and you're playing relatively normally, this will be completely fine. Next, we have Communal. This one will decrease pop housing usage by a solid 10%, and that is really quite great, especially later on. Early on, you don't really need Communal because, of course, you can just build more districts, but later on, Communal is quite a bit more useful because you will start overcrowding your planets, and especially once you start building more habitats and start getting them overcrowded, you're going to see the value in Communal. The next two traits, Ingenious and Industrious, are very, very straightforward. One will increase energy credits from jobs by 50%, and the other one will increase minerals from jobs by 50%. Both of those are very good modifiers and can be used with any sort of empire. Next, we have Natural Sociologists and, of course, Natural Physicists. These two are very straightforward. Both of them will increase their respective research field by 50%, but since physics and society are the two least powerful branches of technology, they are relatively low in the tier list, while engineering is very high in the tier list. I'll explain that when I get to it. For now, let's take a look at Nerf Stapled, which is exclusive to the Biological Ascension. This one will cost 3 trade points, give you extra resource from jobs, and basically make those pops serviles. Those pops will not be affected by happiness, so effectively you will prevent all sorts of revolts, and the pops cannot generate leaders, rulers, or specialists. That is relatively nice if you're planning to have a world with a bunch of workers on it, but having this trait for your normal species is going to be a pain. Like, you will never want to have this trait for your normal original species, but you do have the option of actually modding your species to be that. Moving up to tier A, we start getting into the really good traits that I choose on a regular basis. One of them is Strong. Now, Strong may seem like a very odd choice for a tier A trait, but effectively it gives the same ratio of production per trait point as the other ones, which are Ingenious, Industrious, and Agrarian. It also has the added benefit of army damage, which, while not important by itself, is a nice bonus and helps it get to A tier, while two of the other ones, Ingenious and Industrious, are in B tier. Next, we have Agrarian. Now, it may seem odd that Agrarian is ranked higher than Ingenious and Industrious, but there is a very good reason behind it. That reason is that farmers produce a base of 6 food per farmer, while miners and technicians produce a base of 4 minerals and energy, respectively. That means that you are modifying a bigger base value, and you're getting a bigger value as a bonus in return. That number can then be converted into more pop growth, or can actually be converted directly into more energy. The thing is, if you're selling food on the market with a base 30% market fee, you're getting about 0.7 energy per food. That means that you can just go on the market, sell food, and actually get more energy credits than you would with technicians. Of course, you cannot overdo it, because if you're overdoing it, the prices will collapse, but if you're doing it a little bit throughout the game, it is going to be very efficient and will benefit you significantly. Additionally, there's also the factor of AI being really, really receptive to food for whatever reason, and so if you're doing direct trades with AI, you'll be able to trade like 100 food for maybe 200 energy credits. AI goes crazy over extra food, and if you haven't tried to do the food deals yet, you definitely should, and feel the power of the food production. Charismatic is also very good, because extra amenities will allow you to hold off on building any entertainers or any jobs of that sort. Going for entertainers and any other jobs for the amenities is not really efficient, and will cost you a solid building slot as well as a few pops. With Charismatic, you can very easily hold out for about 2 building slots, and that will allow you to have a lot more production than an empire that is not using Charismatic. Next, we have Adaptive. This one does half the things of Extremely Adaptive, but is ranked higher. That is because its effect is a little bit more relevant throughout the game, because, you know, once you colonize your guaranteed worlds and get them to 90%, you'll be able to get them to 100% habitability using the techs that increase habitability. Extremely Adaptive will make you waste those techs, but Adaptive will allow you to, you know, actually roll with it and get some benefit from that. So effectively, you're getting more benefit per trade point, and that is quite good. Next, we have Intelligent. This one will increase your research overall, and that is really quite nice. Considering how you're going to be getting bonuses to all the fields, and you can still take a single one of those other science traits, it is very good and can be comboed with another one to get some solid boosts in a specific field. Next, we have Robust. Robust is one of those traits exclusive to the Biological Ascension, so it costs a lot and also does a lot. The only problem is, it's not really at its peak by the time you actually biologically ascend, because the habitability is really a bonus you want in the early game, not in the late game. In the late game, you can either terraform all your planets or modify your species to suit the planets. So habitability doesn't really matter there. It does give you a nice 5% bonus to resources, which is arguably not that good at that point in the game. Obviously, you will already have a bunch of bonuses, and so the 5% added on top of all those bonuses is not going to really matter too much. There's diminishing returns after all, and a 5% is not going to do too much. The leader lifespan, on the other hand, is relatively decent. By the time you get Biological Ascension, you'll already be reaching the point where your leaders start getting really old and actually dying, and so extending their life by about 50 years or so is a decent choice. Unfortunately, even with all those bonuses, Robust still does not compare to the S-tier traits, because S-tier traits are just the best of the best. One of the best is, of course, Natural Engineers. Natural Engineers will allow you to get extra engineering research from jobs, and that is very, very good. You see, engineering is the best tech tree out there because it provides early access to things like Strikecraft, Starbases, minerals, stuff like that. The engineering tree has very good techs all throughout the game, and you know, by the end of your engineering experience, you'll be able to build megastructures, and megastructures are of course very solid. Natural Engineers is a trait that will allow you to reach that goal, and in fact, it is a trait that I run pretty much in every single one of my games. Similarly, I choose Rapid Breeders in pretty much every single one of my games. You see, in Stellaris, at least as of this version, pop growth is king. The more pops you have, the more power you can get, because of course, the more pops you have, the more resources you produce, the more science you produce, the more allies you produce, and the bigger and the badder you end up being. So of course, having more pops is very good, and even paying 2 trait points for 10% pop growth speed is an extremely, extremely solid trait. The same thing can be said about Fertile. Fertile is essentially Rapid Breeders on steroids. It will increase your pop growth speed by a solid 30%, which is absolutely ridiculous, and this will also decrease your pop housing usage by 10%. This one will also combo with Communal, so you can potentially get minus 20% to pop housing just from these two traits. The only problem with Fertile, of course, is that the pop growth speed really comes in very late into the game, and so you're not going to be able to capitalize from the pop growth speed as much as you would with Rapid Breeders. And finally, to wrap up all the traits, we have Erudite. Erudite is amazing. It will increase your researcher output and will give you an extra leader level cap. That leader level cap is quite a bit more important at that point in the game, at the point where you're, of course, modifying your species to be biologically ascended. And this one will also give you extra traits on your leaders. For example, all your governors will get plus 5% to engineering, physics, and society research. Scientists will get plus 5% to research speed. And admirals will get plus 5% to ship fire rate and plus 10% to combat disengagement. Combat disengagement is a very powerful mechanic, and if you're not completely aware of it, please go ahead and check out my ship design video. I talk about it quite a bit. Generals get a very similar modifier to admirals, but army disengagement chance is not nearly as important as navy disengagement chance. This trait will allow you to retain more of your armies in case you succeed, but if you don't succeed, the extra army disengagement chance will contribute to you losing the battle rather than winning it. Now before we move on to the negative traits, I want to give a quick mention to Delicious. Delicious is not marked anywhere on the tier list except for in the key as an example, because, well, Delicious is the very definition of niche. If you are running a certain population as livestock, obviously Delicious will be absolutely incredible and probably S tier, but if you're not doing that, Delicious will be beyond F tier. It is that polarized, and it really depends on what you're doing with those pops. Now that we've covered all the positive traits, let's take a very quick look at the negative traits. Obviously, the higher the negative trait is on the tier list, the better it is to choose for your empire, and so something like Unruly is basically a free choice. It will give you plus 10% to Empire's Profit pops, but that is not really significant, and will effectively add, you know, maybe a single bureaucrat for every 100 or 200 pops. Yeah, it's not that bad. But anyways, let's very quickly go through all these traits. So in D tier, we have Quarrelsome. Quarrelsome is obviously bad for its negative unity production. Then we have maladaptive, which is obviously bad because you will want to colonize other planets, and having 10% less habitability will produce a wide variety of penalties and may make some planets really, really undesirable. You only really want to colonize planets with more than 50% habitability, and maladaptive can push some planets into the more or less uncolonizable zone. Of course, you can still colonize every planet, but with maladaptive, it's going to be way harder and it's going to be way more of a pain on your empire. Repugnant will also cause massive pains for your empire because you'll pretty much have to build a hollow theater as your first or second building on your planet. There's simply no way you can get enough amenities without having a whole bunch of modifiers to your planet that require quite a bit of resources to upkeep, such as, for example, the art monument or the decision to distribute luxury goods. Without those, you're going to have a very hard time maintaining your amenities, and even with those, you'll have to waste a building slot for entertainment much earlier than with normal empires. Next, we have Solitary, which will make you build more city districts early on, and of course, later on, it will cause massive issues. Next, we have Fleeting. Now, obviously, if your leaders have a shortened lifespan, they will die off like flies, and you'll have to replace them constantly. That is, if you're playing a normal empire, if you're playing something like a Hive Mind, this will of course be much higher in the tier list, because with Hive Minds, your leaders will start off quite a bit younger. In fact, you can get Hive Minds to start off at year like 5, while normal organic pops start off at year 30 or so. If you are, however, playing as a Lithoid, you will get leader lifespan minus 25 years instead of minus 10. Even then, with Lithoids, you do want to consider choosing Fleeting, because Lithoids as a species will already get plus 50 years to their lifespan, and choosing Fleeting for them is not going to be that big of a deal. Next, we have Slow Breeders. Now, you might have expected Slow Breeders to be in D tier, just because Rapid Breeders is an S tier, but really, the other three traits, Quarrelsome, Non-Adaptive, and Repugnant, cause quite a bit more issues than Slow Breeders. Slow Breeders is just more time that you have to waste growing your pops, while the other ones will actively hurt your empire quite a bit more. So Slow Breeders is not too bad. It's really bad, but it's not as bad as the ones in D tier. Moving on to tier B, we have Slow Learners. You don't really want this trait, but at the same time, choosing it will not really hurt your empire too much. Same with Sedentary, really. Sedentary will increase your resettlement cost and will decrease pop growth from immigration. Pop growth from immigration will hurt you early on, especially when you're colonizing those new colonies and you're getting some immigration going on. However, past that point, it's not really going to be a big deal, and so you could potentially choose this, kind of tank through the negatives in the early game, and just kind of keep it for the remainder of the game. It's not really going to harm you at all, as long as you're managing your planet as well, and unless you're colonizing new planets in the middle of the game, you're going to be just fine. Next, we have Weak. This will obviously hurt your base economy production, but overall, it's not that big of a deal. Minus 2.5% spread across all your base resources is not as bad as minus 7.5% to a single resource, so you can take the loss and just move on. Moving up to tier A though, we have traits that are relative free picks. Decadent, for example, is virtually a free pick as long as you choose the authoritarian ethos and just go with the stratified economy. If you're not going with stratified economy, it will matter a little bit more, but since worker and slave happiness doesn't really reflect on your pop approval, you can choose this and not really suffer any significant consequences. The thing is, even with decent conditions, your workers and slaves only really make up a third of your pop approval, so effectively you're going to be getting minus 3% happiness overall on your planet, and that translates to roughly 2 stability on your planet, which is not all that much. Of course, if you're running stratified economy, this will basically not matter whatsoever, and I don't think you'll even feel any impact on your stability. Similarly, you might not feel that much of an impact from Wasteful. Wasteful will of course increase pop consumer goods upkeep, but as long as you buy or, you know, trade for consumer goods, you're going to be just completely fine. Wasteful is a bit worse than something like Decadent or Deviant, but it's one of the freest picks out there for a negative trait. Speaking of Deviants, it really doesn't do too much. Minus 15% to governing ethics extraction is not that big of a penalty, and overall, you will hardly notice if you're losing any influence from having more factions or having more pops in factions that really oppose you. Like, Deviants is not going to harm you, and the most it could do is like waste 0.01 or 0.02 influence per month by just having a faction that is not as happy as another faction taking the population share for it. The ultimate free pick trait though is Unruly. Not only does it give you a really negligible modifier, it will also give you 2 trait points, which is quite amazing. Like, Unruly is just a must have in 2.6, and until they nerf it, by, for example, reducing the cost to 1 instead of 2, Paradox is going to see a lot of people running this, especially if they're trying to be competitive. But anyways, that'll do it for today. If you want to check out my video on Civics, which is done in a very similar format, you can click on the link in the top right. And if you want to subscribe, you can click on the link in the bottom right. Anyways, thank you all for watching, and I hope to see you guys soon. Bye-bye.